الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمداً عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وعلى صحابته الراشدين وعلى الداعين لدعوته إلى يوم الدين. Praises to Allah. We praise Him. Seek His help, guidance, and forgiveness. Whoever Allah guides, no one can lead astray. And whoever Allah allows to go astray, no one can guide. And I bear witness that there is no God except Allah, alone with no partner or associate. And I bear witness that our Master and Prophet Muhammad is his servant and messenger. May the peace and the blessings of Allah be upon him, upon his pure family, upon his companions, and upon all those who will follow their footsteps till the day of judgment. My dear brothers and sisters, tonight we're doing a continuation of the series that we started last week about the marvels of the number 7 in the Holy Quran. The main source of this material is from the book by Dr. Abdudaim al-Kahir. The title of that book is The Marvels of the Number 7 in the Noble Quran. Dr. Abdudaim Kahir made a search and he put in his book that guidelines pertaining to the search methodology. The mathematical technique followed throughout this research of the numeric miracle is the very basic, long-established mathematical technique known as positional notation or place-value notation. This technique allows for numbers to be represented or encoded and given an order of magnitude, namely digital places, ones place, tens place, hundreds place, etc. After an extensive and detailed study of the Quran's verses, I have come to the firm, and this is a quotation from Dr. Abdudaim al-Kahir, he said, I have come to the firm realization that place notation preserves the sequence of the Quran's words much more effectively than mere counting. And the beauty of this technique lies in its sheer simplicity, since it's based on counting the letters of each word in a phrase and then aligning those letter counts to form a single number without the need to add, subtract, or multiply. This was said by Dr. Abdudaim al-Kahir. Guidelines for studying the Quran's numbers. Any scientific research normally consists of three main components. Number one, one of these is the very data that is being presented. Another component is the research methodology used to deal with that data. And the third, and the most important component is the final result, namely the conclusions that have been made at the end of the research. Data is at the heart of any scientific research, and providing that the data being used is accurate and the methodology applied to the research is sound, then the results of this research will in turn be correct as well. On the other hand, if the data offered is inaccurate and the methodology used is contradictory or not based on any scientific grounds, the final results will inevitably be unconvincing, if not incorrect. In short, for this research to be acceptable, the following must be established. Guidelines pertaining to the research data. Guidelines pertaining to the methodology of the research, and guidelines pertaining to the final results of the research. The data used for any kind of research into the Quran's numeric inimitability should come only from the Quran itself. Many studies into the numeric miracles have lost their credibility when researchers decided to inject numbers from outside the Quran. Moreover, the way in which the Quranic numbers are extracted must be consistent and free of contradiction. In other words, researchers must choose whether to count letters according to their exact way of drawing in the Holy Quran, or according to how they are pronounced. They should not mix both techniques. In this research, the letters are counted precisely as they are drawn in the Holy Quran. This will be detailed and explained in future presentation. But how do we deal with the numbers we arrive at? That's what we find out from the guidelines relating to the methodology of this research. The information presented in this research must be approached and dealt with in a manner that is appropriate, both scientifically and religiously. A random, unscientific approach cannot be followed, because the Quran is a holy scripture from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The basis for arranging the Quranic numbers. In this research, we will encounter a very large amount of numeric arrangements extracted from the Holy Quran. Some of these arrangements represent connecting two or more numbers together to create new numbers which are also multiples of seven. That is, when we are faced with a collection of numbers, such as the chapter 1, chapter number, verse number, word count, and letter count of a particular verse, we follow a specific technique for combining them. This technique is to arrange the numbers into a single number in the following logical order. Number 1, chapter number. Number 2, verse number. Number 3, word count. Number 4, letter count. The reason why arranging numbers in the above order is a sensible approach and is a self-explanatory. Chapters contain verses. Verses contain words, and words contain letters. We must also remember that we will follow the exact order by which the Quran's 114 chapters and 6,236 verses are organized, and this according to the recitation of Hafs an-Nafi. Because we believe that this has been decreed from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and therefore must not be meddled with, just like the Quran's words and letters cannot be altered. And just as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the entire universe and subjected it to the perfect laws of science, He has revealed, organized, and perfected the Holy Quran with its own set of rules and facts which describe the secrets of His creations. That being said, we must bear in mind one more time, and we're going to keep saying this in every presentation. We must bear in mind that the Holy Quran is not a book of science, a book of math, or a book of any other science. It's the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which He revealed and descended upon our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as guidance, clear proof of guidance and criterion between right and wrong for all people to follow His teachings as a way of life at all times. We must also bear in mind that we have written the various Quranic verses exactly as they appear in the Quran, which is absolutely critical in our study of the numeric miracle. And now, let's begin our amazing and spectacular journey. In this presentation, we will examine the miracle which exists in the connection between the Basmala, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, meaning in the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, and other Quranic verses. These connections form a complex and diverse web of numbers that emanate the beauty of the numeric miracle of the Holy Quran. Studying the Basmala's connection with all the verses of the Quran is something that requires a great deal of time and research, and therefore, for the purpose of our study and presentation tonight, we choose two examples. One from the first chapter in the Quran and one from the last chapter of the Quran. A web of numbers. The first chapter begins with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Meaning, in the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. Praise is to Allah, the Lord of the worlds. This is verse 1 and 2 from Surah Al-Fatiha. The final chapter begins with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. Meaning, say, I seek refuge with the Lord of mankind. This is verse number 1 of Surah An-Nas. The Basmala in the last chapter of the Quran is not part of its verses. It merely sits atop of the chapter, just as it sits atop of another 111 chapters in the Quran without being considered part of the verses. Now, chapter 9, Surah At-Tawbah, the repentance, is not included in the count of the mentioned 111 chapters because it does not have a basmala on top of it. The only exception to this is the basmala atop of Surah Al-Fatiha, which is the first verse of that chapter. We will focus solely on the first and the last word of each verse, so people do not think that our choice of words is made randomly, but rather systematically. That is why we always choose the first and last chapter, the first and last verse, and so on. As stated before, the first verse in Surah Al-Fatiha is the Basmala, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And the first of its four words is Bism, in the name, Allah. This word, Bism, has been repeated in the Holy Quran 22 times. 22 times. The last word in the Basmala is Ar-Rahim. And this word, Ar-Rahim, has been repeated in the Holy Quran 115 times. 115 times. The second verse in Surah Al-Fatiha is Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. And the first of its four words is Alhamd. This word, Alhamdu, is repeated in the Holy Quran 38 times. 38 times. The last word of the second verse is Al-Alameen. This word, Al-Alameen, is repeated in the Holy Quran 73 times. 73 times. And now, let's bear witness to an astounding web of numeric connections between the four numbers. 73, 38, 115, and 22. And how they always manages to generate a perfect multiples of 7. Fact number one. The first and last words of the Basmala verse, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, are repeated 22 and 115 times respectively. When combining the two numbers using positional notation or place value notation, we get 11522, 11,522. And as you see in the box, Bism 22, Ar-Rahim 115. And when we put these two numbers in position and notation, we get 1152, which equals to 1646 times 7. This is our first perfect multiple of 7. We labeled this section at the beginning by a web of numbers for a reason, and that is the four numbers in this web, 73, 38, 115, and 22, are so closely interconnected to the extent that it will never cease to amaze us just how many perfect multiples of 7 these four numbers can produce. Fact number two. Now we take the numbers pertaining to the first word of the first verse, which is Bism, and the first word of the second verse, which is Alhamd. The number which represents the repetition of these two words in the Holy Quran is 3822, 3,822. This is not how many times they were repeated, no. This is when we put it in a positional notation, a place value notation. Bism was repeated 22 times, Alhamd was repeated 38 times. So when we put it in a positional notation, we get the number 3822, which equals to 546 times 7. Another perfect multiple of 7. Fact number 3. Now, taking the numbers pertaining to the last word of the first verse and the last word of the second verse, we find this. The number which represents the repetition of these two words in the Holy Quran is 73115. Ar-Rahim is the last word of the first verse, was repeated 115 times, and Al-Alameen is the last word of the second verse, was repeated 73 times. So, using the positional notation, we have 73115, which equals to 10445 times 7, a perfect multiple of 7. Fact number 4. Now, taking the numbers pertaining to the first word of the first verse, which is Bism, and the last word of the second verse, which is Al-Alameen, we find this. The number which represents the repetition of these two words in the Holy Quran is 7322. Bism 22 times, Al-Alameen 73 times. We put him in a positional notation we get 7322, which equals to 1046 times 7, a perfect multiple of 7. Fact number 5. Now, taking the numbers pertaining to the last word of the first verse, which is Ar-Rahim, and the first word of the second verse, which is Al-Hamd, we find this. The number which represents the repetition of these two words in the Holy Quran is 38115. Ar-Rahim, 115. Al-Hamd, 38. When we put them in a positional notation, we get 38115, which equals to 545 times 7, a perfect multiple of 7. We have witnessed 5 closely connected facts that all relate to the first 2 verses of Surah Al-Fatiha, and they all represent perfect multiples of 7. But the most important conclusion of all, perhaps, is that these numbers hardly leave any room for coincidence. Coincidence simply cannot take place this frequently. Nevertheless, we acknowledge and accept the fact that people may well have their doubts, which is why we are now going to apply the same logic to the final chapter of the Quran to see how the very same arrangements maintain this beautiful consistency of being perfect multiples of 7. Having witnessed the astonishing and amazing arrangements between the Basmala and the verse which follows it, the first verse in the Fatiha, in the first chapter of the Holy Quran, the question in hand now is, are the same connections preserved when examining the Basmala, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, and the final chapter of the Quran? The final chapter of the Holy Quran is Surah An-Nas, and the first verse in this chapter is قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. The first word in this verse, قُلْ, is repeated in the Holy Quran 332 times. 332 times. And the last word, Anas, is repeated in the Holy Quran 241 times. 241 times. That leads us to fact number 6. We arrange these 2 numbers together. We have قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. قُلْ 332, and النَّاسِ 241. When we put it in a positional notation, we get the number 241332. 241332 equals to 34476 times 7, a perfect multiple of 7. Fact number 7. Now we will examine the numbers 241, 332, 115, and 22, which are, the 22 is the number of repetitions of the first verse of the Quran, which is Bism. The 115 is the repetition of the word Ar-Rahim, which is the last word of the first verse of the Quran. 332 is the number of repetitions of the word Qul, which is the first word of the last chapter of the Quran. And 241 is the number of repetition of the word An-Nas, which is the last word of the last chapter of the Quran. So this is the word that we have. 241, 332, 115, 22, which represent the Quran's repetition of the first and last word of both the Basmala and the first verse of Surah An-Nas. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Bism 22 times, الرحيم 115 قل 332 الناس 241. Let's now explore this web of numbers 241, 332, 115, 22. In the same way, we investigated the first two verses of Surah Al-Fatiha. First, taking the numbers of the first word of the first verse and the first word of the second verse, we get Bism 22, Qul 332. The number representing the repetition of these two words in the Quran, when we put it in a positional notation, is 33222. 33222 equals to 4746 times 7, a perfect multiple of 7. We now use the numbers of the last word of the first verse and the last word of the second verse. Ar-Rahim 115, An-Nas 241. The number representing the repetition of these two words in the Quran, when we put it in a positional notation, is 241115. Now 241115 equals to 3445 times 7, a perfect multiple of 7. Fact number 9. We now use the numbers of the first word of the first verse and the last word of the second verse. Bism 22 and Nas 241. The number representing the repetition of these two words in the Quran when we put them in a positional notation is 24122. Now 24122 equals to 3446 times 7, another perfect multiple of 7. Fact number 10, finally, we take the numbers of the last word of the first verse, Ar-Rahim, and the first word of the second verse, Ar-Rahim, 115 times, Qul, 332 times. The number representing the repetition of these two words in the Quran, when we put it in a positional notation, is 332115. Now 332115 equals to 47445 times 7, a perfect multiple of 7. So far, and as we have seen, the perfect multiples of 7 explored in this presentation involve only 6 different words: Bism, Ar-Rahim, Al-Hamd, Al-Alameen, Qul, An-Nas. Only 6 words. Nevertheless, these words produced an intricate web of interconnectedness that is so difficult and impossible to interpret as coincidence. This only makes us wonder what kind of astounding precision can we expect to find if we study all the words of the Quran, which amount to more than 70,000 words. SubhanAllah. Again, my dear brothers and sisters, I always like us to conclude with this. We owe it to ourselves, if we were seekers of truth, to ask this question. Could these consistencies have been simply blind coincidence? This is a judgment that we do not make. It's up to you to decide for your own. We simply state the facts of what we believe and try to support our views with evidence that addresses human intellect. Our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not a scientist. He was not a geologist, nor he was a mathematician, to make and put together amazing facts like the ones we have mentioned. He was simply an illiterate man born in Mecca. So who taught him this? And if Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is not a messenger of Allah, then what is he? وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين. My dear brothers and sisters, next Saturday there will be no talk because we have a guest speaker, and inshallah we'll continue this series on Saturday, July the 29th, to have more verses and more facts. May Allah make me and you of those who listen to this speech and follow the best of it. وَأَخْرُ دَعْوَانَا أَنِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ